Good morning. Welcome. It's good to see all of you. Please sign the attendance register if you haven't done so already. The choir will rehearse today following worship. All who enjoy singing are welcome. The choir will sing on Easter. The Easter extravaganza breakfast is being held Saturday, April 13th. We will need lots of help, but our biggest need is lots of candy-filled eggs. There will be many kids here. If you can bring in a dozen or so filled eggs by next Sunday, that would be appreciated. The Easter Flower Forum is available over in Galbraith Hall. If you would like to purchase a flower to make our sanctuary beautiful on Sunday, Easter Sunday, return the form with payment in the offering plate today, or you can drop it off at the office by Tuesday. A Lenten prayer meeting is planned for this Wednesday, April 3rd at 6 p.m. at Highland. All are encouraged to join us as we pray for our churches, town, country, and the needs of each other. The Lawrence County Empty Bowls Dinner is this Saturday, April 6th from 4 to 6 p.m. Ticket price is $10 per person. Children under 12 are free. This event supports the summer food program, which provided over 33,000 meals last summer to children in Lawrence County. Tickets will be available at the door. A free community event to celebrate our oneness is being held today at the Scottish Rite Cathedral from 2 to 5 p.m. Activities include arts, raffles, and refreshments. More information is in the bulletin. And we don't have slides today. The people that run the slides, Lisa, Chad, they're on the pastor nominating committee and they are at another church today. So use your program. We're going to have to go back to actually reading the program. Dawn has a couple of announcements and then we will begin our worship of God.
So Bill already gave a little bit of an introduction. We have an exciting piece planned for the prelude for Easter Sunday. I'm inviting all of you. It would be great to fill the choir loft. It's during the very beginning of the Easter service. It's a very easy song. Even if you can just stay one of the next three Sundays, you will easily be able to learn it and sing it, and it will sound great, and it'll be a great way to celebrate Easter Sunday. And you'll be able to still sit with your families afterwards. The second thing is today is the soup and salad luncheon. We are a great church. One of the things that we do well is we eat. And so everyone eats lunch. And so even if you did not plan to stay, I encourage you from the fellowship committee to stay and have lunch with us. We've got lots of soup and salad today. And this is a great way to get to know who else goes to our church. A church is not just what worships for an hour on Sunday morning. To be a vibrant, growing church, we need to know each other in the pews. And I encourage you today to fill the tables, maybe sit with someone that you don't know, and get to know them. Help us grow our church by really learning more than just the person's name. Hope to see you down in Fellowship Hall right after choir practice.
Thank you. Please stand if you are able to join me in the call to worship printed in the bulletin. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let's pray. Discipleship is a demanding word, O Lord, yet that is the invitation Jesus gives to those who would follow him.
We consider ourselves to be disciples of Christ. That is why we have come this morning, to give our praise and adoration to you, O God.
We also know, Lord, that we are particularly anxious, and that along with our words, we should also give ourselves to you.
O God, help our discipleship become a way of life, more than just a way with words.
We come to worship you, O God, as we ask for your blessing on this our worship, in the name of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. The proof of God's amazing love is this: while we were sinners, Christ died for us. Because we have faith in him, we dare to approach God with confidence. In faith and penitence, let us confess our sins before God and one another with the unison prayer of confession. Let us pray. Jesus, our Lord and Master, so often we have pronounced your name with our lips. It can cause us to feel a little more righteous, but we confess that just as often, if not more so, we have failed to live by your standards of discipleship, and our words of piety have been of little significance. Forgive us for the undisciplined gap that separates our lives from our lips. Most gracious Lord, who desires that your followers live a daily life of discipleship, challenge us today with total commitment, that our words of allegiance will reflect, rather than conflict, with the life we live. In the name of Jesus the Christ, we humbly lift up all our personal sins and come seeking forgiveness. Amen. Hear the good news. This saying is sure and worthy of full acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, that we might be dead to sin and alive to all that is good. Let us remember that in the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. And all the people of God say, Amen. Setting aside any differences that have separated us from God or from one another, let us now share God's peace with each other by saying to our neighbors, Peace be with you.
Well, I've got some things to show you today. As you can see on this tray, what do we call these things here? They're seeds. That's right. And we have all different kinds of seeds. We have some sunflower seeds. We have some pumpkin seeds. We have some morning glory seeds. We have some cosmos seeds. And we have some buckeyes. Now, buckeyes grow up, they're little seeds, they become buckeye trees. You ever seen a buckeye tree? Buckeyes are kind of neat. Once you get the buckeye, it stays a buckeye unless you plant it. So it's kind of cool. And sunflower seeds become sunflowers, and the pumpkin seeds become pumpkins, and these become flowers. But what happens, how do we get the seeds to become the flowers or the pumpkins or the tree? What do we have to do first? But if we just watered them like this, would it work? What do you have to do first? Put it in the soil. You have to bury it. You have to bury the seeds in the soil and then water it, and like you said, and give it nurture, and then it'll become the buckeye tree, the sunflower, the pumpkin, or the flowers or whatever. But the seeds can't remain seeds. If the pumpkin seed wants to be a pumpkin, it can't remain a seed. It has to die. So all these seeds can't stay seeds. The buckeye can't be a buckeye if it wants to be a buckeye tree. It has to die in the ground and then grow up to be the plant or the pumpkin or the seed or whatever. But it can't become a seed. It can't be a seed and a plant or a tree at the same time. And that's exactly what Jesus did. God needed to save us. So Jesus, think of Jesus as kind of like a seed. And Jesus had to die, had to be on the cross, so he could be raised again. Jesus couldn't be Jesus on earth and at the same time be our Savior in heaven at the same time. So Jesus couldn't remain human. He had to die for our sins to be raised on Easter so he could save us. And we do the same thing. We can't go to heaven like we are. We have to die so we can be raised again and live forever. We can't be human and be eternal at the same time. So that's all part of life. So you're like a seed. Jesus was like a seed. We have to die, and then God raises us up like he did Jesus so we can live forever. And that seems normal when you think about it. That's what has to happen. But some people like to remain a seed. No, I want to stay a pumpkin. Well, you don't want to stay just a seed. You want to grow and become something better. And that's what God did for each one of us. We don't have to remain seeds. We can live forever. So let's pray. Dear God, thank you for sending Jesus, planting him among us, and then helping him be raised from the dead so that we could live with him and you forever and ever. We thank you for that miracle, and we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. See you next time.
Will you pray with me? Holy God, help us to know your word and not take it for granted. Move us to hear your spirit afresh with words that may be familiar. Help us to honor you by paying attention to how you speak to us today. Teach us to respond to your call so that we may be ever more faithful disciples. We come to your word on this fourth Sunday in Lent in the name of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Today's Old Testament reading is Isaiah chapter 53, which can be found on page 780 in the Pew Bible. The suffering servant motif, as depicted in this passage, is seen by Jews as Israel. But Christians see the suffering servant as Jesus Christ, which dramatically fulfills Old Testament prophecy through Jesus' atonement for our sins. Let us listen for the word of God and read responsively. Who has believed what he has heard from us? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed?
For he grew up before him like a young plant and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, and no beauty that we should desire him.
He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And as one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised, and we esteemed him not.
Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted.
But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his wounds we are healed.
All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all.
He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he opened not his mouth.
By oppression and judgment he was taken away, and as for his generation, consider that he was cut out of the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people.
And they made his grave with the wicked, and with a rich man in his death, although he had done no violence, and there was no deceit in his mouth.
Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him. He has put him to grief. When his soul makes an offering for guilt, he shall see his offspring. He shall prolong his days. The will of the Lord shall prosper in his hand.
Out of the anguish of his soul he shall see and be satisfied. By his knowledge shall the righteous one, my servant, make many to be accounted righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities.
Therefore I will divide him
a portion with the many, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he poured out his soul to death and was numbered with the transgressors. Yet he bore the sin of many and makes intercession for the transgressors. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We now turn our attention to the New Testament, and we are reading from Matthew chapter 27, verses 32 through 34. And you can find this on page 1060 in your pew Bibles. This passage focuses on the taunts that were flung at Jesus by the passersby and the Jewish authorities. And they all centered around one thing: the claims Jesus had made and his apparent helplessness on the cross. It was precisely there, though, that the Jews were so wrong. They could see God only in power, but Jesus showed that God is sacrificial love. So let's listen for the word of God, the 27th chapter of Matthew, starting with the verse numbered 32. As they went out, they found a man of Cyrene, Simon by name. They compelled this man to carry his cross. And when they came to a place called Golgotha, which means place of a skull, they offered him wine to drink mixed with gall, but when he tasted it, he would not drink it. And when they had crucified him, they divided his garments among them by casting lots. Then they sat down and kept watch over him there. And over his head they put the charge against him, which read, "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." And then two robbers were crucified with him, one on the right and one on the left. And those who passed by derided him, wagging their heads and saying, "You who would destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days, save yourself. If you are the Son of God, come down from the cross." So also the chief priests with the scribes and elders mocked him, saying, "He saved others, he cannot save himself. He is the King of Israel. Let him come down now from the cross, and we will believe in him. He trusts in God. Let God deliver him now if he desires him. For he said, 'I am the Son of God.'" And the robbers who were crucified with him also reviled him in the same way. This is the word of the Lord. Gracious God, may you bless not only the readings from your word, but also the singing of your word and the playing of your word, and now the interpretation of your word, that it all might become your word on this fourth Sunday in Lent. Amen. It was strangely dark. A thunderstorm was blowing up from the mountains. The clouds hid the sun, and people looked up to the sky wondering what was to come. A light rain was falling. Lightning flashed between the thunderheads. It was an uncanny kind of darkness. Women held their children close. They weren't just looking up at the storm, they were also looking up at a man on a cross. And they blinked as the rain hit their faces as they watched this man die. Women were weeping. Some men were sobbing. There were signs of pain from a dying thief on one of the three crosses and the cursing of a thief dying on another. And Simon of Cyrene wiped his tears away with the back of his hand. And Peter stood out on the fringe of the crowd, broken and confused. But there were others looking up at that cross. And they weren't crying. They were laughing. They were mocking, pointing accusing figures of scorn and ridicule with the demonic laughter that enjoys suffering. They hurled insults and cruel jokes at him. He saved others. He himself he cannot save. He healed cripples. He mended withered arms. He gave sight to the blind. He even brought back the dead, but he cannot save himself. Perform a miracle now, miracle man. Come on down from the cross, and then we'll believe you. You who would build a temple in 3 days, you got nails in your hands and a cross of wood, go build your temple. If you're the Messiah, come on down from the cross. He saved others himself, he cannot save. They were wrong, as well as right in their accusations. He could have saved himself. He could have compromised with the priests. He could have made a bargain with Caiaphas. He could have talked things over with Pilate. He could have made his kingdom political instead of spiritual. He could have even called 12 legions of angels to come down and rescue him and show his powers. He could have saved himself. He had the power. But then he never would have been our Savior. It's interesting to note that many times a person is seen sometimes more clearly by his enemies than by his friends. I think it's most apparent sometimes in the political realm, isn't it? A politician will make various accusations against those they're running against and sometimes accurately describe them, possibly better than even their friends. And this was true of Jesus. He was first recognized as the Son of God, not by his followers, but by a demon-possessed man. And look at the portrait of Jesus that's painted by his enemies. His enemies, he was a friend of sinners. And the sign above his head on the cross said he was the King of the Jews. Now that was spiritually true. So the jeers that they threw at him while on the cross, trying to add insult to injury, were really statements of spiritual truth. They were right, precisely because he was saving others. He could not save himself. For this is the law of redemption, folks. It's always been true that saving others and saving self are mutually exclusive. You cannot do one and the other at the same time, as I mentioned to the kids. This is not just rescuing someone like a lifeguard, but saving another's life for eternity. And that is the paradox of salvation. As I told the kids this morning, a seed in an acorn, or for example, any of those seeds, cannot save itself if it's to bud into a tree or a flower. A soldier cannot save himself if he's going to sacrifice for his country. The good shepherd lays down his life for his sheep. Jesus is the good shepherd. There is no other way to save us than for Jesus to lay down his life for our salvation. For isn't it true that love is never thinking of oneself, but to give oneself for the one who is loved? Isn't that what you do? Isn't that how we love, really? Several years ago, four people stood in the office of the President of the United States in a very solemn ceremony. One was a young man, a little boy, a young woman, and a gray-haired couple. And they were there to receive from the President the highest military honor the country can give to any of its citizens, the Congressional Medal of Honor. It was being awarded to the one who had been their husband, their son, their father. His exploits had been read, and tears of sadness and pride welled up in those in the room. And for he had been a young officer, he was in charge of a frontline unit, and in the battle, one of his men pulled out a pin of a grenade, and he was going to lob it into the enemy lines when it slipped out of his hand and fell in the midst of their own company, and immediately that officer fell on top of the grenade before it exploded and absorbed the full impact of the explosion with his own body. He saved others, but he could not save himself. And that's what Jesus did. He fell on the grenade of sin for all of us. So what was said in derision at the cross were actually statements of truth. They meant to degrade Jesus, but in fact they described what was happening and gave unintentional witness to an act of God. And this is the paradox of salvation. He who would save others cannot save himself. And I get asked that question just about every Easter around this time in one form or another. Somebody usually comes up and says, well, Rick, what couldn't God have done it some other way? I mean, why did Jesus have to die? I mean, could not God have saved us without shedding Jesus' blood so cruelly and violently? Why did it have to be that way? Well, let's think about that for a minute. If he'd just been a teacher or a philosopher, that wouldn't have been enough, because he came not only to teach, but to redeem. He said, I came to seek and save the lost, not just teach. Had we been creatures in a creation that's only mechanical, then, well, just a little readjusting here, a little tweaking there, a little shove, a little nudge, and so on, and everything would then eventually be all right. But we're not in that kind of a creation. Had we been puppets on strings attached to God, and all God had to do then was make us dance to a different drummer, but then that would destroy the essence of who we are. We are free creatures. God could only persuade and plead. It has to be a voluntary response on our part. God had to act so we would react of our own accord. In the movie Evan Almighty, some of you might have seen that movie, Evan Almighty, Morgan Freeman plays God in the movie. And Evan, the hero, is played by Steve Carell. And God asks Evan, Evan asks God, God, how do you get someone to love you without coercing them? And God said, welcome to my world. There are no shortcuts that God could make to get us to love him. The only way was to become involved with us, to become one of us. He could not save his creatures and at the same time spare himself. He had to get involved. And that's what God did in Jesus Christ. He came as the embodiment of the perfect man in an imperfect world. Here was the revelation of what we can be and are supposed to be. When God sees sin, a just God must either inflict punishment or assume it. God chose the latter, to assume it. Jesus had no sin, but God made him become sin so that in Jesus Christ we could become right with God. It wasn't his death he died, it was ours. It wasn't his sin that he embodied, it was our sin. Sacrifice is the law of redemption, and it's a commentary on God. He saved others because he would not save himself. And without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sins. In Revelation 21, John talks about the gates of heaven as being made of pearl. We've referred to them ever since as the pearly gates. And we pass through the pearly gates into heaven. And there's a reason for that. The symbolism of those pearly gates is found in the process by which that lovely gem is formed. And you all know how that happens. You know that when a grain of sand gets into an oyster, it irritates the tender membrane inside that oyster, so the oyster secretes a milk-like substance that covers that grain of sand, that irritation, and it keeps covering that irritating grain of sand for the life of the oyster. And then when the oyster is opened, we get a pearl of great price, which is the product of suffering. In Revelation, this gem then is placed over the portals of glory to remind we who enter that you're entering because of the suffering of another. As our Old Testament lesson said this morning, Isaiah 53, but he was wounded for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the punishment that made us whole. And by his bruises, we are healed. And that's the paradox at the heart of our salvation. God chose to save us in that fashion. And that means not only are we saved, but we are caught up in the same movement. I don't know about you, but I, for one, am eternally thankful that he did it that way. God loves us that much. Max Lucado, a fellow preacher from down in Texas, tells the story about a family who was visiting Disney World in Florida one year. And they were inside Cinderella's castle. And it was packed with kids and parents. Suddenly all the children rushed to one side because Cinderella had entered. Cinderella, the pristine princess. And she was perfectly typecast. A gorgeous young girl with each hair in place, flawless skin, and a beaming smile. And then she stood waist deep in a garden of children, each wanting to touch it and to be touched. The other side of the castle was now vacant, except for a boy, maybe 7 or 8 years old. It was hard to determine his age because of the disfigurement of his body. Dwarfed in height, deformed face, he stood watching quietly and wistfully, holding the hand of his older brother. And you know what he wanted. He wanted to be with the other children. He longed to be in the middle of the kids reaching for Cinderella. but you could feel his fear of yet another rejection, of being taunted or mocked. You wish Cinderella would go to him. And guess what? She did. She noticed the little boy, and she immediately began walking in his direction, politely and firmly inching through the crowd of children. She finally broke free, and she walked quickly across the floor and knelt at eye level with the stunned little boy and placed a kiss on his face. The names are different, but isn't the story almost the same? Rather than a princess of Disney, we've been considering the Prince of Peace. In both cases, a gift was given and love was shared. In both cases. But Jesus did more. A lovely one performed a gesture beyond words, yes, but Jesus did more than Cinderella. So much more. Cinderella gave only a kiss. And when she stood to leave, she took her beauty with her. The boy was still deformed. What if Cinderella had done what Jesus did? What if she'd assumed his state? What if she somehow had given him her beauty and taken on his disfigurement? That's what Jesus did. The fact is, it was our pains he carried. It was our disfigurements, all the wrongs with us. It was our sins that did that to him, that ripped him, that tore him, that crushed him, our sins. He took the punishment, and that made us whole. Through his bruises, we get healed. Make no mistake, Jesus gave more than a kiss. He gave his beauty. He paid more than a visit. He paid for our mistakes. He took more than a minute. He took away our sin. My friends, I hope you understand the significance of the sacrifice that God has gone through for you. This is Lent. It's a time of sacrifice. So what are you doing? Gracious God, may the words on my lips and the meditation in our hearts always be acceptable to you. You are our rock and our redeemer, in whose name we pray. Amen. Let us stand. Thank you. remain standing as we dedicate our lives to God by reaffirming our faith using the Apostles' Creed. Christians, what do you believe? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He ascended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. As the ushers prepare to collect today's offering, let us pray. As Christ was offered in obedience to you, O God, so we offer ourselves and our gifts to be used in your service. As you took Christ's sacrifice and filled it with your life and power, so use our gifts and transform our lives, that we may be the living presence of your reign on earth, now and always. We pray in the strong name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen. Let us return to God, the offerings of our life and the gifts of the earth. As we come to our prayer time together, please note the prayer chain on the back of your bulletin. So many folks there need our prayers. Betty Kitchen and Lester Housechild and Nicole Jackson. Betty Rue, recovering from her broken leg. And also the family of Bobby McCreary. We'll know more. They're still planning a memorial service for Bobby McCreary. And we'll, as soon as we know when that is, we will let you know. Keep that family in your prayers. For so many more, we need to pray. Pray with me. Lord, why do we become so easily stirred to anger? Something is said and we take it the wrong way. Something is done and we take it personally. Is there some paranoia in us? Is our skin too thin? We become defensive when it is suggested we're not doing our job well. We're not the parents we should be. We're not the Christians we pretend to be. We're not the neighbors we say we are. When it comes to criticism, it's hard, Lord, to consider objectively what is said, to evaluate carefully what is suggested. So we speak before we think. Our defenses take over. Help us, Lord, to get behind our defensiveness. And when we feel threatened or judged, raise questions in our minds so that we may think before we react. Why does this upset me? What feelings are in the one judging me? How can I respond so as to hear what I need to hear about myself? What should I dismiss as wrong judgment, and what should I receive as needed insight? Lord, these questions are tough to tackle. We are tempted to protect the image we have of ourselves, even if it means an angry response, hating in return, or just becoming deaf to all that which we do not want said or done to us. We remember, Lord, that when you were reviled, you did not revile in return. We want to be like that. Grace us with your love. Grace us with your compassion and with your forgiveness, that we might become the disciples you want us to be. And help us during this time of preparation for the greatest Christian event in the history of the world, that we may realize the sacrifice involved, and that we might also become part and parcel to that sacrifice. Then others may know us by who we are and by what we do. Help us, O God, to act on our faith. We lift up to you those families who have lost loved ones. We thank you for the life of Bobby McCreary and what she meant to so many here at this church. But we rejoice that any of those who are gone are not lost to you. For in the joy of the resurrection, we affirm that life goes on, so that we come to you with the private prayers of our hearts that only you need to hear. We come with joys and concerns that fill our minds. We lift up to you our secret sins and our private joys and those names who weigh on our minds and hearts that need your tender touch. We lift up all these prayers in the silence of our souls. And now, in the spirit of Jesus of Nazareth, always your word to us as the Christ, hear us as we join all the world today in praying the prayer your Son taught us when we pray to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let us stand to sing. worship is over, but our service begins. So may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May God give you grace, never to sell yourself short, grace to risk something big for something good, and grace to remember that the world is now too dangerous for anything but truth and too small for anything but love. So may God take your minds and think through them. May God take your lips and speak through them. May God take your hearts and set them on fire. And may God lift up his countenance upon you and give to you and those you love and those whom nobody loves his peace. Dismiss us from this place, but never from your presence. We pray in the name of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.